вообще для людей вот загадка до сих пор, как же оно работает, потому что это видно, что это 3D макеты, да, и они резко меняются, и вот это для людей загадка. Ну сейчас в YouTube, наверное, эту загадку откроют.
Welcome back to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technologies. Last year we made for you a brief video tour at the National Museum of Chernobyl, and back then we promised to reveal its great secret. Well, the place itself is a must visit if you are in Kyiv, but besides this incredible collection, there is something truly unique. It is one-of-a-kind three-stage diorama which displays the Chernobyl nuclear power plant before, during and after the disaster of 1986. I remember it very well when I was a child, and needless to say that even after 30 years since it was created, it still gives a great impression to people. Especially when they discover that actually it is completely electromechanical. So today we for the very first time will go to the technical room and explain you how this stunning piece of technology actually works. It was made by a small group of engineers and artists and opened in 1992. And we had an amazing chance to meet two of them, Oleksandr Gorshinyov and Valery Trubinsky. We had a long freeform talk and they gladly shared some interesting details about that work. The main element of dynamic dioramas is a huge semi-transparent mirror. If you have just two stages with a visual change in between, you place two 3D models behind and above the mirror, and then by illuminating them from different angles, you get a smooth visual transition. Back in the day, a popular use of this technology were dioramas demonstrating an apartment before and after a fire. And in Kyiv also was a large exhibition about firefighting that featured one of those. The team has been servicing that system, and given that newly created Chernobyl Museum was also curated by firefighting service, they were requested to create diorama about Chernobyl disaster.
Сделали формакет один к десяти, то есть, чтобы самим хотя бы знать эти размеры точные, ну, с чего-то начинать-то надо. Мы сделали формакет.
The technical room has quite a little free space, so not all parts are visible during the operation. So before we go there, take a look at this layout. So, technically there are three different models used, and those for the first and third stages are positioned on a prism-shaped mount that can tilt. Behind them there are two backgrounds which exchange their position. However, the model for the second stage, together with its background, is placed turned 90 degrees above, and it is mirrored. Below the mirror there is a horizontal sliding door which prevents unwanted light coming. It gets open when the change is happening and closes after.
Ми робили рік не менше. А до цього ще трошки думали, як це зробити.
By a lucky coincidence, the original schematics still exists, and just a brief look gives a good insight into how complex all this is. Well, according to creators, it was really hard to get required components. Many the team could get were actually discarded leftovers from military factories. Well, after recent upgrade, the diorama now is controlled by a custom-designed microprocessor system, but back in the day it was completely analog. So they needed to find more than 100 different relays, timers and switches to make that machinery work. But some solutions were truly makeshift. For example, the motor that changes the models is actually from the washing machine, which belonged to one of creators. So the operation of the diorama starts from opening of the vertical sliding door. And the first stage represents the nuclear power plant before the accident. The model for this stage is here, behind this panel, which is the background you can see now. And all models were intentionally built somewhat distorted in order to compensate the optical distortions caused by position of the mirror and a large distance to a viewer. Well, there is a little Easter egg added by creators, so that propaganda banner says peaceful atom into every home. Well, after the accident, that sentence got quite an ironical context. So, it is a peaceful evening of April 25th, 1986, and outdoor and indoor lights are slowly switching on. And the power plant starts a night shift. A deep night of April 26 is coming, and at the Unit 4 starts the infamous test of the turbo generator. And soon starts the second stage. So what you see now is the second model and its background. As I said before, it is mirrored and positioned 90 degrees above the mirror. But the previous model is no longer visible because of the change of illumination. So while you watch the second stage, the system prepares for the third one. Well, we cannot see it, but right now here is opening the horizontal sliding door to give the space for changing the models. Next, the first background moves up, and during this operation we still continue to see the mirrored model and its background. By the way, you might have noticed that we have now a few helicopters in the sky. Given that light now is coming from above, it is also for a while possible to see the main mirror. And finally, the third background is being lowered to match the new model, and approximately at the same time the horizontal sliding door is moving back into its position. And now we have a final transition to the third stage, and here we can see the sarcophagus over the Unit 4, so-called shelter object. And as you can see, the transition was really quick, because it was made with changing of illumination of the models, and frankly this part puzzles viewers the most. So, once this part is finished, the phone sliding door will raise again, ending the demonstration for a viewer. But, as you're about to see in the technical room, the system will make everything ready for the next run. By the way, the music used is the arrangement of a few tracks by Eduard Artemyev, the composer of the soundtrack of the famous Stalker movie by Andrei Tarkovsky. Nowadays, the music comes from an MP3 player, but originally it was on a tape reel recorder. It had a long 6-minute loop tape, which passed a large box, and that tape was equipped with reflective stickers that were read by sensors to precisely match the operation of the diorama. Well, the sound feels somewhat monophonic, and there is a reason for that.
Мелодія мінялася, значить, плівка порвалася.
Постановити її не можна було.
Не можна було її відновити ніяк. Не можна було. Тоді ми з сином Бетховена запустили цю
гру. П'яту.
Ні, не п'яту. Тоді якось знайшли зйомку старої діорами, старої музики. І тоді по цьому звуку якось відновили цю.
Задавали питання, як, де робили цей самий. Нас рекламували, але в кінці кінців не вийшло так, щоб ще зробили.
Більше в нас не було замовлень таких.
Ми надіялися, так.
So, that said, this diorama still remains absolutely unique thing, and really hope that this episode will build just one more bit of recognition for those talented engineers. And by the way, if you have any questions you would like to ask the developers, just write them down in the comments and we'll send them to them. And that's it for today. And meanwhile, check our Patreon page, because there you can find various insights into the life in the Chernobyl zone and get ready for our new episodes. See you next time.